Growing up without our parents was a rough experience. But the worst happened when my brother got into drugs.
He spent all our savings to purchase drugs.
Isolated himself from his family members and spent most of his time with his friends.
I need high as a day like this.
He got into many drugs, from pills to weed, syrup, and he injected himself. He became very violent and got into trouble. He spent days outside without coming home. The drugs began to eat him gradually. It was painful seeing him lose his mind. But it was more painful when we lost him forever.
Stay safe. Don't do drugs. This is Narco Tales.
Hey viewers, welcome to Narco Tales, the show that shines a light on the darkest corners of substance dependence and illuminates the path to recovery. I am your host, Netta, and I'm proud to share these stories with you.
Please pay attention, it starts from the foundation. Everybody needs somebody.
Everybody needs some love.
You turn a blind eye and care nothing less. Say it's just business, all about the money. You are so unbothered as long as the pay. Say it's just business, all about the money. You know they're on a fast lane, but you've got business to run. So you look away the other way.
It concerns me, it concerns you. Either kill love, either kill dreams, either land people for jail. War against drug abuse.
Today, we're joined by a true warrior who has turned their struggles into a beacon of hope. Hello and welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
How are you feeling today?
I feel very good. Happy to be here.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Can you start by sharing a little about yourself and your background?
Okay. My name is Larry Ode. I'm from Cross River State. I'm the last child of three siblings, and I grew up with my auntie, basically. So she's an educationist and disciplinarian, basically. So, yeah. I think that's a little bit about me.
Okay, so let's start from the earliest memories of your struggle. What led you down the path of substance dependence?
I think I was influenced by a classmate then, and he was about the oldest in the class. So
what class was this?
I think that was my gesture.
Okay.
Yeah, the agri-farming time, when we handed out the farm diary, mm-hmm. and we're all giving a reach to...
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah,
I did that.
Exactly. So... I was a brother, basically, and the agric farm gave me space to leave the hostel and even after school hours. So I could easily say, I want to go check on my ridge in the farm.
And but the farm was located inside the school.
Yeah, but it was not too far from the hostel.
Yeah.
And it was not inside the school compound, basically.
Okay.
So it was a little bit kind of in between the hostel and the school. Sorry, and the hostel and the school premises. So it gives me chance to leave the hostel and still leave the school premises when school is in session.
Yeah.
So I'll go to the farm to check on my ridge, and I always notice this, my classmate, his name was Andrew. Yeah, he'll be in the farm, but not by his ridge. He'll be on that one tree rolling stuff, and then I'll be seeing a whole lot of smoke coming out of that side.
And you were curious.
Yes. So that curiosity in me drove me there. And then I went to him one day and I was like, Alpha, can I try this? And then he was very reluctant at first, but after pressing, he was like, okay, he gave it to me. I tried it and I didn't feel so good. I had to rush to the hostel.
How did you feel?
I felt drowsy and I think my head was very heavy.
Yeah.
So I rushed to the hostel and I soaked Gary in a very big bowl. I rushed it and I finished the gari, and then I slept for a couple of hours. I slept for so long. So waking up that evening, I could not really focus on anything, but then I really look forward to doing it again.
Mm-hmm.
So the next day in school, I went to him and I was like, can I try this thing again? And being the precious nephew, he was very skeptical about giving it to me again because he knew he was on his way to getting caught.
Yeah,
so he didn't want to risk it. And then he was like, no, at this point, I should just go about my own stuff. So I went back to the hostel that day and I went to my cousin. His name is Obadi. So I was like, Alpha, I beg, Ofi, make one waka. He said, yeah, what's up? So I already knew this place my brother goes to get stuff because, mind you, then my elder brother was already using. So we left the hostel and we got to the place. And then I went to the dealer. I was like, Alpha bros, I beg, Ofi, get stuff. Mind you, we're wearing compound wear as brothers and stuff. So he was kind of not really sure if he should give us stuff. But of course now, if you front the dealer your money, they're always willing to sell. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I paid for stuff and he rolled it for me. And then I smoked. And I think that was the day I became an official smoker. Because it felt good and better than the previous day. Do you understand? So experiencing that stone and the feeling, the psychoactive nature, it was very, very cool. Though reaching the hostel back was the problem because I didn't know how to walk. Yeah. I mean, I was very high and stoned. I didn't really know how to.
Were you with your cousin at that point?
Yeah. So we had to just wait for a while. So the chips would go down a little bit and then we started the great trek back to the hostel. On reaching the hostel, I was happy because I took some back with me. And then I remember the talks about trying it with noodles and some other stuff. So I had to try it again with this box iron. The charcoal iron.
Yeah,
there's a way we used to open the head and I use this Ovaltine can, the empty one to make noodles and we tried it with the...
So you put that can into the...
The top iron. Of the iron.
Okay.
So the heat on that serves us the stuff to cook. So we made the noodles. I made the noodles with the cannabis and I tried it too and it was very, very cool. After some hours, it kicked in and I enjoyed myself. And after that day for so long, I became an addict to it. Yeah. Actually, I think what drove me to it was because I grew up in a school environment and we always caged, you know. We didn't have that freedom to meet friends, to explore new things. So when I explored that a little bit and it was fun, my whole life just circled around it. So I think that was what led me to it basically. Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about, you mentioned something earlier about your older brother.
Yeah.
He was already using at that time.
Yeah.
Was he aware that you also started using?
Nah, he didn't really know till I got admission into her institution.
So that means you used from that point, which was your just three, right?
Yeah.
All through senior secondary school.
Yeah.
Okay.
At some point I added cigarette too. Yeah, because cigarette was kind of legal and you can smoke cigarette anywhere. And where I'm from, I think one of the things we like to do is to drink a lot.
Where are you from?
I'm from Cross River State.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, so we like to drink a lot and you can easily find teenagers in bars drinking beers and stuff. So since I was too young to smoke weed in the open then, so it was kind of very cool to smoke cigarette and stuff while drinking with friends. So it made it just, I felt like I was a very cool kid, you know. Yeah, that was.
Did you ever get caught in school?
Not really, because I was very, very, very careful. I didn't ever get caught in school.
Okay, guys, it's time for a short break. When we're back, we're going to hear more of Larry's story. Stay tuned.
I was the head boy in my primary school, senior prefect and best graduating student in my secondary school, but drug abuse almost ruined my life.
I was on an average of 2 grams of cocaine per day.
I was taking 8 ampoules of pentazocine daily.
European shisha, cocaine.
I became a user, a dealer, and a gangster.
I saw other users drowning. I knew I didn't want to be like them, but I was already trapped.
My family disowned me.
My employment was terminated.
I sold my car, sold my house. I'll go out out well-dressed and return shoeless, shirtless in exchange for drugs.
I was seeing things that were not real and I once stabbed myself because I felt something crawling under my skin.
I contacted NDLEA and started therapy.
I spent 3 months in therapy.
I spent 8 months.
It's easy to relapse, but your mind has to be stronger than the cravings.
Drugs does not love you. You are not the one using drugs. Drugs are the one using you. Say no to drug abuse.
Welcome back, viewers. Thank you for staying with us. Okay, so let's talk about the challenges that you might have encountered during your experience.
I think that was the biggest part of it all because it wasn't easy, actually. And to me, at that point, it was fun, though.
Yeah.
Because I got so addicted that I could not do without it. And the feeling of being stoned was, I think, the greatest feeling I had to look up to every day. And it was one part I could not really do without. If there's any time, or let me say any hour of the day I'm not stoned, I just don't feel right. After I actually made up my mind to quit, it was not really easy. And, you know, addiction is one very big thing to deal with.
True.
And it's not like I had to go to a rehab or something. It was just strictly my willpower and God. Yeah, I think that was what did it. I had the willpower to stop it, but I still found myself going back to it every now and then.
So you'd relapse? You'd...
Yeah, it was a back and forth circle mm-hmm. for me. But at some point, I just knew I needed God in it. So I went back to church and I went to the chapel. I'm Catholic. So I went to the church and I spent some time in the chapel praying. I fell asleep in the chapel. And then I woke up. After I made up my mind to quit, it was really, really hard bonding with friends. Because the whole fun part of our hanging out and chilling was kind of removed from
yeah.
it. So it was very hard and I became like the black sheep among friends. Do you understand? And you know it's very hard to be among friends when everybody's on something and then you're just acting all brand new and giving them vibes like
you. Oh, so you still maintain the same circle of friends?
Actually, I think that was my mistake, but yeah, I did. You know, it's hard to start making new friends at some point in life when you're very used to your
yeah.
old circle and all of that. So it was very hard for me to just stand up and say, okay, because I want to stop doing all of these things, I'll start making new friends and all of that. I mean, it's like basically for me, it's easy to make friends, but it's hard to make friends.
Wasn't that a struggle, you know, recovering and then still being with the same people?
Actually, it was, but I feel like we've bonded to a certain level already,
okay.
You know. These are friends that I basically grew up with, do you understand? So we knew ourselves very well, and then it was just hard for me one day to just stand up. Same way I decided to stop doing stuff, I'll just decide to start making new friends that don't do these things because I've decided not to do them. Do you understand?
But did they understand and respect that you were recovering and then you were out from that lifestyle? Or did they keep pressuring you into it?
Actually, I don't think they respected my decisions because at some point, I think one of them poisoned stuff for me. Because
poisoned
cannabis for
okay.
me. Because at that point, it was still the roller coaster of going back and forth. I was not really off it yet. So there are times I'll be so much tempted to go back to have a few puff and
yeah.
stuff. So, okay, like my friend, this one, he called me one afternoon. I was like, he has this new loud for me. Actually, he doesn't sell stuff. He was not a dealer. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So he just told me he got this new consignment and he was going to give me a very good price and discount and stuff. And even though I already made up my mind to stop doing stuff, hearing that was like, you know.
Yeah, you probably got interested.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, don't worry. I went over to his place. I picked up stuff, made the transfer, and then I went back to my usual spot of doing stuff. And then after rolling a joint and I took a few puffs, I noticed my eyes started twitching. I had this pain of headache, and then I started shaking and sweating. I was not just feeling myself. I had to rush to the house. It was about 6, 7-ish in the evening. Mm-hmm. So I rushed back to the house and I tried sleeping. And the more I tried to sleep, it got worse. So the next day, I had to rush myself to the hospital as early as about 5:30 in the morning. So I have this personal relationship with my doctor. So I'm always very free with him, do you understand? And I was plain. I told him, see, doc, I know I told you I'll stop smoking, but see what happened. I actually smoked yesterday and see how I've been feeling after I smoked. So he took note of all the symptoms I told him, and I think he ran a few tests, and then it was like, you've been poisoned.
Oh, wow.
So he wrote down some things on my, you know how doctors write those gibberish stuff
with their writing.
Exactly. So I could not really tell what he wrote down on my file, but he asked me to give it to the nurse, and they took me to one ward. I was given a couple of injections, and I was dripped for about 3 days.
That must have been very serious.
Yeah. But the more I took in the drip and stuff, I got to feel better. So I think on the third day, I was good enough to leave the hospital. And that's how I got discharged. So I got to know my friends were not really happy with me leaving the circle, because I made some decisions to affect my life in a positive way. And I think it made them feel like they were not as good, or do you understand?
Yeah, they would always
made them feel
like
less of themselves, because I was basically, I think that step was one step that was going to break me from that circle. So yeah, it was a very big one for me, but I came out strong.
Okay, so before we draw the curtains on this episode, I have one question for you.
Okay.
So what made you realize that you needed to quit?
Okay, actually, it was very obvious, because I actually have so lot I wanted to do, but I really could not do them because I was on substance. And, you know, the more I use these things, the will to do those things I really wanted to do for myself, I couldn't pull through. So, and I realized I was not growing any younger. So what's the point of using my youthful age when I'm meant to work and be productive?
True.
To be catching crews up and down, do you understand? So I actually made up my mind to stop, because I knew I had to get serious with my life and to be productive for myself. So that's where the whole idea of stopping stuff came from, and I think with God I was able to achieve it.
Okay, so let's go into recovery. How was recovery like?
Okay, I think recovery is one of the best part of it all, because I actually got busy, and I think that was one way I had to overcome the urge of using, because every now and then, having been addicted to it before in the past, I still get the urge to do stuff, you know.
Of course
I'm human, so every now and then I get the urge to do stuff, but I just had to get busy and productive with my time. I'm a content creator, basically, so I try to be always busy. If I'm not on set, I try to at least think of concept to shoot and stuff.
Yeah.
So, I just try to keep my head busy and occupied with something productive. I think that's one of my biggest breakthroughs.
Thank you very much, Larry. Today's conversation was a very powerful reminder that our struggles do not define us.
Mm-hmm.
A very big thank you to our amazing guest, Larry, for coming on the show.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Remember, behind every dark cloud, there is always a silver lining. I'm your host, Netta. Until next time.
Don't do drugs. Don't do drugs.
Don't try it though. Choke you, he go steal your sunshine, yo. He go shock you, oh. He don't kill him any youth for my area, even for your area. When you start it to stop, he no go easy. As you dey drag him go, he dey drag you down. What I come out for my eyes, oh. When I remember all the guys.
ghetto. Hey, many of them kicking for ghetto. Some cartoons for ghetto. Make we don't forget to. Go to Tokito, say. Busybody. If you die, you go sad. Oh, yeah, help me tell somebody. Hey, rock up, you see, body, oh, body, oh, body, oh.
This message is brought to you by the National Drug Law Enforcement Agency, NDLEA.